Hi, my friends. Apitka Tava. I hope you had a beautiful Yom Kippur and an uplifting Yom Kippur. Here are some words of Torah for Parshat Haazinu. We are approaching the end of the Torah and the end of the life of our great teacher, Moshe Rabbeinu. After presenting Bnei Yisrael with the Shira of Haazinu, God instructs Moshe and tells him, Alei el har ha'avarim hazeh har nevo. Ascend this mountain of Avarim, Mount Nebo, that is in the land of Moab, facing Yericho. See the land of Canaan, which I am giving to Bnei Yisrael as their inheritance. On this verse, there's a very bizarre commentary in the Targum Yonatan. When Moshe heard the words, Alei El Har, the very first words of the commandment, go up to the mountain, before he heard the command to look out on the land of Canaan, for that first split second, he thought to himself, oh, God is about to command me to go up to a mountain, just like he commanded me that time 40 years ago to go up to Mount Sinai and give the people something. I should get the people ready and sanctify them for receiving some new communication, some new mitzvah. Hashem responded to Moshe by saying, no, Moshe, you're mistaken. Not every command to climb a mountain is for the same purpose. This time, it's so that you can see the inheritance of Bnei Israel, the land of Canaan. It seems as if the Targum Yonatan is noticing the verbiage God employed when commanding Moshe to go up to the mountain. Notice that the first words of our verse are almost identical to the words that Hashem said back at the time of the giving of the Torah, when telling Moshe to ascend the mountain to receive the tablets. God there said, Vayomer Hashem el Moshe, Alei Eli Hahara. God said to Moshe, ascend to me on this mountain so you can receive the tablets. Hashem chose to express the command in such a way that for the first few words of the sentence, Moshe would get his hopes up that God wanted him to act again in that same capacity as he had done so many years ago in the heyday of his role as lawgiver. But this only begs the question, was God taunting Moshe? Why couldn't he have first said, Moshe, in preparation for your death, I'm going to show you the land of Canaan, ascend Mount Nebo in order to see it. That would have spared Moshe that split second of nostalgia and hope that maybe there was one more thing for him to do for his people. Perhaps we can draw multiple messages from this Targum Yonatan Midrash. Firstly, instead of viewing this as God taunting Moshe, perhaps Hashem was simply reinforcing for Moshe why it wasn't in his interest to lead the Jews into Eretz Yisrael. Hashem was teaching him, when you hear the words, ascend the mountain, you immediately associate that with some holy metaphysical mission of connecting the spiritual realm with the physical. But sometimes, Moshe, climbing a mountain is just climbing a mountain. The Jews are going to have to do plenty of mountain climbing in their journeys through and conquest of Eretz Yisrael. You're not the person they need, since your head is in a completely different space. This mountain is therefore called Har HaAvarim, which literally the word Avarim means transition, in that it represents a transition between your type of leadership, which was to connect the Jews to the spiritual realm, and their new existence in Canaan, which will require them to connect more to the land. This was a statement of consolation to Moshe, that he should not view his imminent death as a punishment, but rather a necessary change in management of the Jewish people. But secondly, it's a lesson, I think, for all of us. This passage teaches us to welcome change in our lives. We may encounter familiar faces, places, and things as we age, but as we change, our relationships with these familiar things also changes. To illustrate, you've been walking down the same street for years, never noticing a particular shop, and then all of a sudden you realize it's been there all along. Or you see someone in shul or in some social circle, never giving a second thought to the possibility that that person might even be your soulmate. And then someone says something, and all of a sudden you look at them with new eyes. I know of more than one story where a couple went out, decided that they weren't meant for each other, but then years later, they met again. Because of their new stage in life and new experiences, they realized that they were actually perfect for each other. We also tend to superimpose our past experiences upon new things in life. I may have known a person named Jane when I was growing up who was particularly mean to me and even bullied me. When I meet a completely different woman named Jane years later, I may carry some baggage with me that predisposes me to not want to like her just because she shares the same name with an old enemy. And if my spouse wishes to name our newborn daughter Jane, well, she can just forget about it. What this Targum commentary is teaching us is that as we move through life, we should be aware of the baggage we're carrying around and try to lighten our load by jettisoning some of that unwanted baggage. If when looking at a mountain, you see Mount Sinai instead of the mountain in front of you, maybe you're stuck living in the past and you should try to reorient yourself to the present. Welcome the new reality and try to see it with a new contemporary set of eyes. I believe this is an important message when starting off the new year. This is the first Shabbos after Yom Kippur, and we've been given a new lease on life. But part of that new year and new lease is the imperative to make this new year actually new. In order for all the blessings that Hashem wants us to have for this year to actually reach us, we need to consciously become part of the new present instead of living in the past. Even when we encounter familiar people, places, and things, we should try our best to disconnect negative associations with those things and create new connections that provide optimism for the future. I know that when the shul was closed for several months this past year, many had a hard time coming back, and it may still be hard for some. The first time I came back to the main shul after having been locked out of the building for so long, I noticed some of my old papers and drushos that I had left on my shtender from months before. The memories all flooded in, and the trauma of the previous months hit me. We all have similar triggers, such as hearing a voice or a series of words or seeing someone or something from our past, which causes memories of the past to flood in. For you, it may be walking past your old school, which causes you to relive some of the experiences of your youth, or it may be visiting an old house you lived in or an old familiar friend. Sometimes the nostalgia is good and heartwarming, but other times it reopens old wounds. The same can be true of certain parts of our religious lives. I may associate going to shul with a negative experience I had in my youth when someone yelled at me or otherwise made me feel unwanted. I may feel a negative attitude towards prayer because when I was younger and raising my children, I never had the time to daven properly. There are so many examples of how experiences from our past color our approach to our present. In order for the new year to be new, we should take the best parts of our past and leave behind the painful parts. Let's make sure that when we see the mountain in front of us, we know what it's for in the here and now, instead of trying to apply past experiences to the new mountain. I know that many people are trying to get things back to the way they were before the pandemic, but it's also important to realize that there are new realities and that certain things will never go back to exactly the way they were. Accept this new year and its blessings in that context. Ascend the new mountain and realize that it's nothing like the mountains you've climbed before. This should be a source of great excitement and optimism for the future. May we too climb the great mountain that leads us to the land of Israel and the great redemption ahead. May we see it, dear friends, b'mehera b'yameinu, amen. Here's wishing you a beautiful Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom. All the best to you, my dear friends.